The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GameCon Radio or its affiliates.
Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your world.
I am a poor wayfaring stranger, a traveling through this world of woe. No sickness, toil, nor danger in that bright world to which I go. I'm going there to see my Father. I'm going there no more to roam.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your game. We rock your world. Tonight, we're going to rock your world with a new independent film that's coming out, Saving Lincoln. It's directed and written by Sal Litvak. He'll be joining us in about 15 minutes. The song you heard after the intro is sung by Dave Alvin, and it's a part of the film. He sings it during a very poignant scene in the movie. I'm really excited about this project, this movie, this guest. Lincoln was our 16th president. He was assassinated during his second term. And I don't think there are many presidents that stood the line like he did. And I can't wait for Sal to join us. I want to thank everybody in the chat room, everybody listening on auto players and all the places that you can listen to us. You can go to GameCon Radio, and there's a chat room on the main page if you want to join us there. You can ask questions during the interview, and we'll try to ask Sal questions. I do have some crazy but news tonight. And first, I want to remind everybody, we have wicked weather coming. My daughter has been told to pack a bag for 3 days to 5 days because they expect Ohio to really get creamed. So people in Ohio, you're going to get hit first, and then it's going to move through to the East Coast. So be ready. Have your candles ready. Have everything you need in case you lose your power, because they're saying this is going to be a pretty rough patch of weather. So everybody fare well through the storm. I also want to remind everybody that we are going to be dipping into really frigid temperatures all over the country. Animals aren't weatherproof. Get them in. And please report animals that are being left out in horrible weather. They're not weatherproof. They do get cold. And we need to be better than what we are. We really need to be better people than we've been lately. Let's see. Captain Yoakum has released a statement asking people to bring in animals. That's with the New Jersey SPCA, so I'm passing that along. Crazy butt news. Wichita police in Kansas are hot on the trail of mice that chewed through bags of marijuana kept in the police storage facility. The three packages were evidence seized during an arrest in 2009. The rodents apparently became they made their homes in it, nested in it, and they started eating it. So Police Lieutenant Doug Nolte says, we've got some stoner mice. They're looking into how they can catch the mice. The culprits were operating on a much smaller scale than they thought they were, but still in all, they can't have mice eating the marijuana. But it's pretty funny because now they're trying to catch these mice, you know, so put a cat in there and you'll have a stoner cat with them, you know. Can you picture them opening this door and there's a bunch of stoned mice and a cat in there? Hey, dude, what's up? You know, I think it would be hysterical. But anyway, nobody's going to arrest them. They're just going to try to catch them. So everybody, you know, just relax. Iran. You got to love Iran. Iran loves to find new and better ways to mutilate people. So now this week they've released a new way to deal with thieves, and it's called the finger cutting machine. And if you're convicted of theft, they take you out and they use this mini guillotine type thing and they cut your fingers off, you know? So that's one of the things that Iran is doing to enhance humanity, you know, finding faster and more efficient ways to cut body parts off. You know, you gotta love Iran, you know. I don't know who would ever want to go there, really. Another thing we have going is Kevin Wallen. He's a Monsignor Meth. That's what they call him, Monsignor Meth. He comes from Hartford, Connecticut, and he was arrested because he kind of imitated that movie, that it's a TV show, Breaking Bad. And Breaking Bad is about a chemistry teacher who is losing everything because he comes down with cancer. So he starts cooking meth, and he becomes a meth amphetamine lord. Well, evidently, Monsignor Wallen decided that he wasn't getting enough money in the house. So he's been suspended because they found out he's been dealing meth. He's allegedly having methamphetamine mailed to him from his conspirators in California and making more than $300,000 in sales out of his apartment in Waterbury, Connecticut. And he realized he needed a way to launder this money, so he opened a small adult video and sex toy shop in the nearby town called North Haven, named Land of Oz and Dorothy's Place. You know, the Catholic Church can't catch a break with these guys, right? I mean, I have to hand it to him. He's bringing in money. I don't know if he's helping people out in his parish, but for crying out loud, you know, you got to give him props for being enterprising. That's the word I'm looking for, because I don't want to call him a scumbag. I don't understand how he could consciously do this, saying he's a priest, but he's under arrest and he's been canned, you know. They're canning him for it. So, you know, what are you going to do? I'm telling you, the Catholic Church really, they need to hang it up, because I think they need stronger rules on how they're getting these priests, Teddy, these priests working for them. You know, but that's crazy, but news. As I said, we've got a big storm coming towards us. It's going to hit the Ohio Valley pretty soon. Frigid temperatures. And again, please, everybody be very, very careful. Get your animals out. If you need chains on your tires, do that. Make sure you have water, candles. Make sure you have everything you need that you can take care of. Because we're getting hit pretty badly. Tornadoes, extreme weather, you know, it's kind of scary what's going on. So our guest is going to be coming on in about 6 minutes. And February is President's Month, you know, and Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln, was our 16th president. When people ask me who my favorite president is, I always say Lincoln. And the reason I say Lincoln is because He wasn't a god. He wasn't perfect. He wasn't a man without sin or anything wrong with him. He was just a guy who ended up in the presidency during a time when our country was going to implode. Literally, it implode. It was just going to explode. There were so many things going on. What happened is this man ended up standing on a line to defend the Union. And whenever you read anything, Horace Greeley had released a letter that Lincoln had sent to him. And Lincoln said, if I can maintain the Union by abolishing slavery, I will. If I can maintain the Union by allowing slavery, I will. Because at the end of the day, his job was to maintain the Union. And it was really a rough thing. You're talking about states that succeeded. You're talking about the worst possible scenario. You had, and it was all political. And that's another thing. This man had to stand in line knowing it was all political. The North was mad because the South was running everything because they had the big money. So I'm excited about this movie because we're getting a different look at Lincoln through the looks, through the eyes of one Ward Hill Lamon. He was a marshal. He was a partner, a law partner of Lincoln's. And the movie that's being made about it, well, what is made about it, is going to be released in February, is Saving Lincoln. And it's about how this U.S. marshal took it upon himself to save Lincoln and keep him alive so that the United States would prevail and come out in one piece. So we're going to try to call our guest now and see if we can get him on.
Hello.
Hello, Sal.
This is Sal.
This is Mo. Welcome
to
my lair.
Oh, you know what? I got to turn off my computer, don't I?
Very cool.
Okay.
Okay.
Hey, Mo. Nice to talk with you.
Yeah. I am so excited about this project of yours. It's an incredible look from a different window of President Lincoln. And first, tell everybody who you are.
Hi. I'm Salvador Litvak, and I directed Saving Lincoln. I wrote it with my wife, Nina Davidovich, and produced it with my producing partner, Ruben Lim. And we made a movie in a way that hasn't been done before, in a style that we developed and that I named Cinecollage, which I'm sure we're going to be talking about. And Saving Lincoln is the true story of Abraham Lincoln and his bodyguard, Ward Hill Lamon, featuring sets created from actual Civil War photographs.
How did you get the idea for this?
The idea to make the movie at all?
Yeah, or, I mean, right at the beginning. I mean, you know, when did you turn around and say, gee, I'm going to go look at this archive, and what led to this?
You know, Mo, what I love about your show is that we have time to get into this.
Good,
see,
that's good.
So this story began years ago. It actually began many years ago when Nina, my wife, was 8 years old, and she found a book of Abraham Lincoln's favorite jokes on her parents' shelf. Mm-hmm. And as a child, I mean, she was just kind of amazed. What do you mean this famous president has a joke book? And it fascinated her, and it stayed with her. And so she's really had a lifelong fascination with Abraham Lincoln. And when we got together, I really responded to that. And I came to share her fascination. Abraham Lincoln is this wonderful, you know, compilation of contradictions. Mm-hmm. He's a guy who is brilliant, but had no formal education. He is an incredible statesman, and yet he just loved jokes. He is a guy who really wouldn't go 5 minutes without telling a funny story. You know, he presided over the greatest crisis in our nation's history and took us forward, you know, to really create the United States as we know it today. But he, a man who, by his own admission, could not wring the neck of a chicken in a time when, you know, people slaughtered their own chickens for dinner all the time. Mm-hmm. He couldn't do that. And yet it fell to him to give the orders that sent hundreds of thousands of boys to die.
Right.
Just an immensely complicated and wonderful man. And so we were really always determined to tell his story. And so what happened was we finally said, look, let's just do this. I went to film school. I came out to Los Angeles to go to film school and to make movies. And I met Nina out here. It turned out that we had a lot of things in common, including that we were writing screenplays, and we'd each written separately. And the first thing that we did together as a writing team, and this was even before we were married, was to write an Abraham Lincoln script. At that time, there had not been an Abraham Lincoln feature film in many years, decades really, and it just seemed so obvious to us that, well, the great American movie would be about the great American, Abraham right. Lincoln. And we set out to do that. Abraham Lincoln is the second most written about human being. So the literature is immense, and the research was a huge undertaking, but we went into it absolutely as deeply as we could, and wrote many drafts of the script. And after 2 years, we had a polished screenplay, and that screenplay was called Lincoln's Hat. It was a different story than Saving Lincoln, or a different approach, let's say, to the Lincoln story. In that the challenge always when you're making a Lincoln movie is there's too much information. There's far, far too much to tell that story in 2 hours. So you have to figure out a way to limit the information. And what we had for Lincoln's, it was called Lincoln's Hat, we had a visual device, which was Lincoln's hat was in every scene, even if Abraham Lincoln wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
We were very proud of that script, and we had an agent. The agent liked it a lot. She set a date that it was going to go into the studios on a Friday, and because there hadn't been a Lincoln movie in a long time, it started getting some attention. What's called the tracking boards in Hollywood started to light up, and you know, things were looking great. And on Wednesday of that week, we got a call from Nina's sister during the night. Nina's sister lives in Paris, so it was morning for her already. Mm-hmm. And the news had just broken that Steven Spielberg is making a Lincoln movie. He bought Doris Kearns Goodwin's book, and Tom Hanks is going to play Abraham Lincoln, and it's going to be huge, and everyone's going to get Oscars. And Nina freaked out.
Yeah, I would imagine so, yeah.
And I said, ever the optimist, said, well, look, this has got to be good for us. I mean, first of all, our challenging historical drama just became a obviously commercial idea. And, you know, whatever their approach is, our approach will be different. The subject of Abraham Lincoln is so large. And somehow this will work out. And Nina, who had worked at a studio, said, you are so naive. This is a disaster. And her reaction was much more realistic than mine. I mean, our script at that moment became, you know, toxic. I mean, it wasn't that no one was going to buy it. It was that no one would even read it.
Right.
And, I mean, it was really crushing after 2 years of work that nobody would even read the fruits of our labor. And, well, you know, we just had to move on. And, I, you know, ever the optimist, I said, look, I didn't come here to sell screenplays to studios. I came to direct, to be a filmmaker. And we're going to find a project that we can make, and we don't have to wait for somebody else's green light. And, you know, so we looked around, took a little time, a few projects that started and stopped, and then finally we found the right idea with the right backer, and we made our first film, which is called When Do We Eat? An irreverent but inspiring comedy about a Passover Seder and a family that, you know, has a lot of problems like all families do, and over the course of one night is able to, every individual, make a little bit of progress and find a lot of togetherness within the family. And that movie's done great for us. It's become a cult hit, and for a lot of people, When Do We Eat is a Passover tradition. They watch it every year.
Yeah, I mean, really, doesn't family, I mean, I don't care what holiday it is, everything happens. All the bickering, all the trouble comes out, and then suddenly by the end of it, oh, that was the best holiday dinner we ever had. And it actually almost comes to fisticuffs. But then eventually they look at each other and go, oh, I remember such wonderful dinners. You know, we had such great times. It's just funny. All families are the same in all traditions.
Exactly. Exactly. That's exactly right. And I think that's why people have responded to it.
Mm-hmm.
So that was good for us. And now we had become a different kind of entity. You know, now we were produced writers and filmmakers. So it was great. You know, once you've made a movie, you know, other doors open. And more importantly, you've learned what the difference is between writing, you know, that looks good on the page and writing that survives all the way through the process to the screen. And, you know, so then we went on to set up other projects. And, you know, we wanted to do something a little bigger. And, you know, that just takes time. And we were meeting with the usual obstacles. And as all this time was passing, what was not happening is that Mr. Spielberg, you know, was making his Lincoln film. It just hadn't happened.
Right.
After a few years, the Tom Hanks version of that Lincoln film went away, and Liam Neeson became the Spielberg Lincoln. And then a few more years passed, and then that project, you know, morphed again. And during all this time, you know, we're incredibly frustrated because we want to make our Lincoln movie. We have a script, but what people always say is, well, no, Steven Spielberg is about to make a Lincoln movie. You know, year after year, he's about to make a Lincoln movie.
Mm-hmm.
And don't get me wrong, I like Steven Spielberg's movies. I mean,
yeah,
he's definitely
do
one of my inspirations.
I do too, but don't stall everybody, because you know, it's kind of like, I'm going to do what I'm going to do it, so nobody else does it, and nobody gets a chance. Either, you know, do it or don't, you know?
Exactly. So, you know, he's not making his, and we can't make ours, because any minute now he's going to make his. That was mm-hmm. the story for years. And so finally I said, look, I'm an independent filmmaker. I'm going to find a way to make our Lincoln movie independently and not wait for anybody else's green light. You know, and as soon as I started telling my friends that here in Los Angeles, they said, well, that's crazy talk. What are you talking about? A Lincoln movie is a period drama. You can't make a period drama on an independent budget. You know, here, look at this script, Sal. This is about a regular guy falls in love with a porn star. Or mm-hmm. look at this script. This is, you know, these teenage slackers battling, you know, drug addiction or angst or abuse or, you know, the stuff that normally is independent movies. And I like independent movies. I like those kind of independent movies, but we wanted to make an Abraham Lincoln movie.
Right. Yeah.
And it had become so personal, Mo, you know. Mm-hmm. We'd lived with Abraham Lincoln for so long, it was like we felt we knew him and we knew stuff about his story that we needed to share, and we owed it to him to do it. You
mm-hmm.
know? And you know, so we said, look, we're just committing. I don't know how we're gonna do it, but we're committing. We're just gonna do it. So we went back to our script and said, you know, is the script good enough? And the thing is that by, you know, having gone through the process with When Do We Eat, we grew as writers, and we said, you know, we could do better. We could write a better script. Hold on a second. This phone is
not a problem.
But I've got another one ready. Hold this. All right, are we on?
We're on.
Good, okay. So I said, you know, Lincoln's hat is cool. I mean, it's very cool to have a visual device for limiting the information, but a hat is not a character. You know, what we need is a point of view of Abraham Lincoln that's a person.
Mm-hmm.
And we went back into our research, you know, all those books about Lincoln that we'd highlighted and taken notes in. And the book that always spoke to us the most is Carl Sandburg's Lincoln, which was written in the 30s. You know, it's one of the oldest biographies. But Carl Sandburg was a poet, and he had a certain way of capturing the spirit of the times. And he, you know, had interviewed people who lived during that time. That was the advantage of a biography written in the 30s. And Ward Hill Lamon just came right off the page to us. It's like, no, this is the guy. This is amazing. You know,
mm-hmm.
No one knows about Ward Hill Lamon.
No, I have to admit that. Nobody knows about him.
It's amazing, right? Mm-hmm. Ward Hill Lamon is the only friend that Abraham Lincoln brought with him from Illinois to Washington. A couple other guys came on the train, but nobody came into Washington. You know, that was Lincoln's. That Lincoln said, "I just want you there." The quote was, "I want you to come with me. It will be handy to have you around." You know, and the reason Lincoln wanted him there is because he liked Lamon. Lamon was funny. Lamon enjoyed Lincoln's jokes and told the same kind of jokes. Lamon played banjo. I mean, there's no radio or TV back then. If you wanted music in your life, you needed a friend who played an instrument.
Right.
And Lamon, you know, was a good banjo player and a singer. He certainly was handy in a fight. When they were law partners, you know, in rural Illinois in the late 1840s and 1850s, what it meant to be a lawyer was that they were called circuit lawyers. And the reason for that is that in these little towns in rural Illinois, when people would have disputes and need to go to court, right, they would wait a few months until the court came to town. There was no courthouse in town, but the lawyers and the judge would sort of ride around the towns, and, you know, every few months they'd be in your town, right? And so they'd come in the evening, and they'd stay at the tavern, and they'd tell stories and jokes and stuff all night long, and then the next day they'd hold court and do all the cases and then ride on. So the circuit lawyers were really always on the road, you know, and it was, you know, essentially the Wild West. And Lamon was a guy you wanted to ride around with.
Mm-hmm.
He was good with a gun. He was good in a fight. He's just a good guy to have around. And, you know, and like I said, Lincoln just enjoyed his company and invited him to come to Washington, position unspecified. So... Now, what Lamon wanted, by the way, because he helped Lincoln quite a bit during the presidential campaign in 1860, and the position he asked for was to be the ambassador to France, Ben Franklin's old job.
Oh, okay.
And Lincoln said, "Well, you know, I want you near me."
Mm-hmm.
I know that Lamon would have been the best ambassador to France. But he ended up doing something much, much more important.
Can I break in for a minute?
We need to
go to a commercial break, and right after the commercial, we're going to play the audio for the trailer, Saving Lincoln official trailer. We're going to play the audio from it so everybody can hear the official trailer. And then we're going to come back and talk about Lamon and how... he and Lincoln worked out together, because I've got a lot of questions and observations, and I think this is, like, so interesting. We'll be right back. This is GameCon Radio with Sal Litvak, and we are talking about the new-to-be-released movie, Saving Lincoln.
Just a reminder, guys, all our talk show hosts here at GameCon Radio volunteer their time, but you can always show your appreciation. Click on the tip jar and give them a little love. I'm sure maybe your predictions will come out a little bit better. And that's how we roll here at GameCon Radio. We rock your game and your paranormal.
is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to GameCon Radio. Why? Because it rocks!
Lord knows I valued Mr. Lincoln's life more than my own. But keeping him alive these past 4 years was nigh on impossible.
No president has ever stood in the field of battle!
Lieutenant, remove Marshal Lamon from the fort.
This is your evidence for the claim I need no guards?
Killers are coming, Mr. President. It is the enemy's only hope.
There exists an organized plot to assassinate me.
You went to the theater unattended.
I will be spared until my purpose is accomplished.
Mr. President, win or lose,
we keep hitting.
You have lost your own people, sir. 3 years of slaughter and no end in sight.
That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain.
I could not mourn my own brothers, lest the papists call me a traitor.
The lack of any success exasperates Europe. They speak again of interceding. If that happens, all is lost.
Jill, I need a victory.
Something to show that the ship of state is not in fact rudderless.
The Lord heard our cries, Mr. President. The cries of my people. And he remembered us. And he sent you to deliver us.
The President of the United States!
Welcome. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameTimeRadio.com. We rock your game. We rock your world. We're going to open the lines if you want to call and ask questions. And the number should be 732-707-7709 if you want to talk to Sal Litvak about saving Lincoln. A lot of people, you know, I know you found this incredible person who seems to be his best friend. They were both lawyers together, traveling on the circuit, and then I know that they separated for a while. When did Lamon actually join back up and decide to back Lincoln's play for the White House? Because I know he lost one. He also backed him for the Senate, but he lost that race.
Right, that was the famous Senate election with Stephen Douglas in 1858 that produced the Lincoln-Douglas debates, and Lamon was involved with Lincoln there. And you can really tell that Lamon loved Lincoln because he was a Democrat when he lived in Virginia, and when he came west to Illinois, became friends with Lincoln. He ended up becoming a Republican just to stay with his friend. And then in 1860, Lamon helped with the presidential election. Those elections are very different than elections are today. You know, you didn't go stumping everywhere, making speeches every day. People really spoke on your behalf for the most part. And then the Republican convention, which took place in Chicago that year, that's when it happened that you would choose a nominee. It wasn't done with primaries. And the whole country expected that William Seward would be the Republican nominee, but Seward had too many enemies. And so Lincoln ended up being a kind of compromise candidate. And because the South couldn't agree on its candidate and the country was essentially already falling apart, Lincoln, you know, went through as this plurality president who got elected with not a majority of the vote, and boom, fate had landed Abraham Lincoln in the White House during the nation's greatest crisis, and he brought Lamon with him to Washington. And it was on that train ride to Washington in 1861, before Lincoln had even been inaugurated, that the first assassination attempt occurred. What people don't realize is that they were trying to kill Lincoln all 4 years, even before he was inaugurated in the first place. That's not something that began at the very end with Booth and his conspirators. And this plot that happened during the train ride was known as the Baltimore Plot. Word of the plot was brought to Lincoln by a private investigator that he knew from his days doing legal work in Chicago and Springfield by the name of Alan Pinkerton. Pinkerton reported that there was a mob of desperate characters based in Baltimore. Their plan was to create a diversion with a bit of a riot, and while to draw off the police. And while that was all going on and Lincoln had to change trains in Baltimore, assassins would slip up to the president and plunge their knives into his side. And what Pinkerton suggested was to steal a march on your enemies by riding into Washington tonight rather than passing through Baltimore tomorrow as they expect. And to accomplish that, we're going to just go quietly as a passenger train, not letting anyone know that, you know, you're the president-elect, and I will ride with you. And Lamon said, I will ride with President. I will ride with Mr. Lincoln. He wasn't the president yet. And Pinkerton said, you know, no, we have a plan. This is the way we're going to do it. And Lamon said, yes, I am riding with Lincoln. And Lincoln himself said, I will ride with Hill. That's what he called Ward Hill Lamon. He called him by his middle name, Hill. Pinkerton went along, of course. But it was really at that moment that Lamon appointed himself the president's bodyguard. Remember, there was no Secret Service. This idea of assassinating a president was brand new. It had never happened before. And Lamon just stepped into the role at that moment and never left it. When they arrived in Washington, two things happened as a result of bypassing the Baltimore plot and deactivating it in that way, defusing it in that way. Number one, the papers reported nationally that this new president, this uneducated guy from outside the establishment who, you know, is not what we would normally think of as presidential material, had snuck into the Capitol like a thief in the night, totally throwing the dignity of the presidential office in the trash. And he was criticized so much, right? Now, really, the decision was, A, not to get killed, and B, to not endanger his family by putting them through this, you know, this riot that was going to happen in Baltimore. But as a result of what they did, Lincoln was so soundly criticized that for the next 4 years, he never wanted to be seen riding around, you know, with guards. I mean, they wanted to put a regiment of soldiers around him at all times, and he just flatly refused. And the only person that he tolerated around him as a bodyguard, for the most part, was Ward Hill Lamon. And so just to give Lamon a salary so that he could be there and, you know, have an official job, they gave him the position U.S. Marshal of the District of Columbia. But, you know, really what he did is guard the president for the next 4 years. And he did that as a bodyguard. He did that as the head of the marshals, who also acted as detectives. And there were other plots that they uncovered during the 4 years. But also, and just as importantly for us, who remember our whole point in this was to tell an Abraham Lincoln story, Lamon was just always there. He was the companion. He was the buddy. He was the guy that Lincoln would unwind with at the end of a terrible day. And they were all terrible days because the pressure was just unrelenting. Mm-hmm. And so it's from this unique perspective that Lamon witnessed everything that Abraham Lincoln went through during the 4 years that he led the nation through the Civil War.
Yeah, I've read a lot of things like Pinkerton kind of poo-pooed him, and Todd Lincoln, tried to downplay his part in Lincoln's life. But yes. In two of the most famous pictures, photographs of Lincoln, there is Lamon.
Is Lamon, yep.
Yeah, he's in two of the most important ones, the one where he's meeting with the generals, and then at Gettysburg. And I couldn't help but think he's dressed almost identically. He was also almost as tall as Lincoln. And it kind of made me think maybe he was like a decoy, you know? They're not sure which one of them it is. At least the president's got a 50-50 chance of not being killed because they shoot me instead.
Very observant, Mo. Yeah, Lamon, you know, Lincoln. The average man at that time was 5'4". Lincoln was 6'4". I mean, can you imagine? He's a foot taller than the average man. And Lamon was almost as tall as Lincoln. I think he was 6'2". You know, so they were really the twin towers walking around.
Yeah.
And they both wore the same top hats. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, I look at that and think, how could anybody say that the man wasn't a close associate. If you don't want to call him a friend, you know, how can you not even call him an associate because of those two pictures right there? That to me says volumes, you know. It isn't like one of the other cabinet members. It isn't somebody else. It's this guy, this banjo player there, you know. And even with the ones with the generals, he's sitting, which is a nod to respect. He's not standing. He's just the black dog sitting on the side of the picture, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say that the metaphor you just used, you called him, so mm-hmm. faithful. Mm-hmm. And there's a great description by John Hay, who was Lincoln's secretary all 4 years, and he and Nicolay, the other secretary, wrote a wonderful biography that was, I think, 10 volumes long. They really reported everything that happened. And there's just this great description that Sandberg uses from Hay of Lamon habitually, you know, when he just, you know, when he was so frustrated that Lincoln didn't want protection and would leave him behind, and Lamon just, you know, insisting on protecting the president, mm-hmm. often ended up sleeping on the floor outside of Lincoln's bedroom, you know, with just a blanket, you know, on him and like a sofa cushion and his many weapons at his side, because he always carried at least two guns and a Bowie knife and, you know, maybe a small gun and brass knuckles. I mean, he was always super well armed. But yeah, his fidelity to Lincoln was just absolutely unwavering.
Let me ask you, descriptions have said they could not have been two different people. Can you talk about the difference between them? That it's extraordinary that they were so close, but they were yet two very different kinds of people, right?
Very different kinds of people. Lincoln, you know, Lincoln was an incredibly shrewd politician. You don't get to be a shrewd and a politician that is so successful that he becomes president without having a wonderful sense of people and how your words affect people and how your actions affect people. So he was just always wonderful at making and maintaining friendships and relationships and, you know, finding common ground with the people around him. Lamon was a lot more of a bulldog.
mm-hmm.
He just, you know, he would see what he wanted and go after it, and he would speak out, and he was not political at all. And that's why, in many ways, he's received, you know, short shrift in history. I mean, the other people that were, around Lincoln and writing accounts of what happened in the White House were politicians and had a keener sense of history, and their writing and their analysis is more important to historians, you know, who are talking about, okay, well, what was the meaning of these events nationally and even internationally? But what Lamon was, like I said, a buddy, you know, who was, mm-hmm. who was so faithful to Lincoln, and all he cared about was Lincoln, so he didn't really care who he offended or, you know, or what was said by him or about him. So, you know, for example, you mentioned Robert Todd Lincoln earlier, and yes, mm-hmm. Robert Todd Lincoln had a problem with Lamon, and that problem, which happened, you know, happened later, it was after the White House years, but it ended up being a big problem for Lamon. What happened was in later life, you know, things were not easy for Lamon. First of all, it was known that he was the president's bodyguard, and, you know, Lincoln died, right? So
mm-hmm.
that must be Lamon's fault.
Right.
No, it was not Lamon's fault at all. He was not present at Ford's Theater on the final night because Lincoln sent him away on a mission a few days before against Lamon's will. And we'll certainly come back to that. But the pass that Lincoln wrote for Lamon, he sent him to Richmond, finally actually to be an ambassador, you know, to go represent Lincoln's interests in Richmond during Reconstruction. And he wrote a pass, a little piece of paper, so that Lamon could pass through the military lines. And it said, please allow Ward Hill Lamon and companion with ordinary baggage to pass to Richmond, April 11th, 1865. And Lamon carried that piece of paper in a silver box in his pocket for the rest of his life, you know, so that he could show people, well, this is why I wasn't there. You can see that, you know, things were tough for him forever.
Yeah, you know, people judging him, yeah.
Exactly. And so one of the things that he did later in life is he wrote one of the first biographies of Abraham Lincoln. Now, Abraham Lincoln, you know, was not universally loved, for sure, while he was president. I mean,
right.
There were so many people that were against him and hated him. But he certainly had a very large number of people who absolutely loved him. And when he died you know, there was a reverse train ride from Washington back to Springfield matching that inaugural train ride. Unfortunately, this was a funeral train ride. Hundreds of thousands of people came out to pay their respects. So, I mean, the sort of ennobling or almost, you know, sanctification. What do you call it when you make somebody a saint? I can't remember that word.
Beatification.
Of Lincoln began almost immediately, right? So,
mm-hmm.
So in those years following Lincoln's death, all anybody wanted to hear was that man was a saint and everything about him was saintly. And Lamon wrote one of those first biographies that was a little bit more human. It wasn't that it made Lincoln look bad. As Lamon put it, you know, Abraham Lincoln is perhaps the only man in history that the more closely you look at him and the more human you understand, the more you understand him as a human being, the more you admire him. But at the time, any kind of personal detail was not, you know, was not so welcome, and certainly not welcome by the Lincoln family.
Yeah.
So when that biography came out, Robert Todd Lincoln completely went on the attack and said, Lamon is nothing, my father never cared for him, you know, he's overstating his own importance. And at that moment, everything that Lamon said or did became suspect. But, you know, everything that he put into that biography has basically been confirmed by historians since then. And, you know, they do consider him a valuable primary source. He's just not the guy you go to for analysis of politics. He's the guy you go to for what was Lincoln really like? What was
right.
it like to be in his company?
Right, and you know, we do tend to put people on pedestals. John Kennedy, look at what we did with him. I mean, you know, he had affairs, but you know, still people have him on this pedestal. You know, and I guess families, you also have to understand where Lyman's coming from. You know, you use what you have to survive. And if writing a book, which I understand was kind of like a ghostwriter, took his notes and wrote the book.
Yes, that particular book was written by Chauncey Black. And, you know, Lamon supervised it, but I think he certainly wouldn't have written it that way himself. But you're right.
You gotta eat, man. So if that's what
getting older. Exactly right. Now, the book that mattered to us is Recollections of Abraham Lincoln. Now, that's not a book that Lamon published in his lifetime, but the writings in it are all his. You know, he would write stories for magazines, for newspapers, and telling it to friends. And it was his daughter, Dorothy, who collected all that material, edited it, and put it together in Recollections of Abraham Lincoln. And that's just a fantastic book. You know, that's where you really get the voice of Lamon and this wonderful portrait of Abraham Lincoln. And actually, one of the things that we're doing in conjunction with our film Saving Lincoln is we're creating a new edition of Recollections of Abraham Lincoln, illustrated with these wonderful vintage photographs from that era, and that's going to be appearing soon on our website, savinglincoln.com, where you can also learn about our movie, by the way.
Yes, there is also a Saving Lincoln on Facebook that anybody wants to find. All they have to do is look at my Facebook, and it's one of my likes or links or whatever. So the book, he wrote the books afterwards. Let's just talk about these two incredible men. You find this character, you find this man, he's flesh and blood, and say, there's our hook. Where did the pictures, the photographs come in? How did that come into play?
Thank you for getting me back on track, Mo. So now we found Lamon. We had a new take on Lincoln. We went back to work. I mean, you know, this was another huge job. It was a new script. You know, Lincoln's Hat was a good script, but Saving Lincoln was basically a whole new script. We put a lot of time and effort and you know, blood, sweat, and tears and passion into our new script, and then we had it. And, you know, meanwhile, it's the same issue. Steven Spielberg has not made his Lincoln movie. No one's going to help us. So we got to find an independent way to make our movie. Now, when we went back to do the research the second time, I spent a lot of time in the Library of Congress website, the online prints and photographs division. This is an incredible resource. Anybody can do this. You go to loc.gov, and there's all these photographs from the Civil War, thousands of them. They've been digitized at an incredibly high resolution. I mean, incredibly high. You can download these pictures. The photographs themselves, even though the photography was so primitive at the time, they were made on 7x9-inch glass plates. I mean, these are huge negatives, much bigger than we use today. The Library of Congress digitizes them at this high resolution. You download it. You can zoom into these pictures. I mean, you can go in, you know, 500, 600, 700%, and you're still looking at a very crisp image. It's amazing. And you can just really get lost in these pictures and exploring these pictures. And, I mean, I just went there to, you know, to really think about the places, the locations that our story was taking place in and that our movie ultimately would occupy. And then one day I had the aha moment. You know, I said, look, I've seen movies like 300, Sin City, Sky Captain in the World of Tomorrow, and a wonderful French film by Eric Rohmer called The Lady and the Duke, all of which, you know, shoot on a green screen stage and make all their environments using visual effects in post-production. And I said, you know, we could do that. But instead of creating these environments from scratch with matte painters, we could use these vintage photographs in the Library of Congress. I'm already imagining the story taking place there. Mm-hmm. What if we actually put our actors into the world that Lincoln and Lamon occupied? I mean, the 1860s actual world. And, you know, I told people, and most people said I was crazy. A few people said, that sounds really interesting. Maybe you could really do that.
Something, you know, like a Black Mariah type deal, right? From Edison. Remember Edison? He had the Black Mariah, the black box that they did all their filming in. That's kind of the concept you're talking about, right?
Yeah, well, he had his own studio, right? He had his own film studio, and that Black Mariah, I'm sorry, I recognize that term, but that doesn't refer to his camera, that refers to the
I
way
thought
he was...
it. Yeah, I thought it referred to, because my father-in-law worked for him, I thought that it was the actual room, because it could be manipulated to let light in different ways, and they called it, everything was black, so they called it the Black Mariah.
That makes sense to me. All right, so basically, it's their studio, and in a sense, yes. I mean, it's the same spirit. In fact, we called it our black... Okay, and eventually what I had to do was find actors, all of my actors, my whole cast, and this was done very, very specifically and strategically. Everyone who worked with us had to have stage experience, right? Mm-hmm. All actors who have theater experience have worked in little black box theaters, right? And I said, our green screen stage, and we ended up needing a giant green screen stage, we're going to think of it like a black box theater, you know? You're not going to have what film actors normally have in a period drama, which is the whole world right around you, you know? You're going to have furniture, you're going to have props, you're going to have costumes. But, you know, the rest of it, you're going to have to use your imagination. You're going to have to rely on each other to stay grounded in reality. I'm going to show you these photographs and what it's going to look like in the end, but, you know, as actors, you're really going to have to rely on stagecraft in order to, you know, to bring this world to life. And we did a lot of testing on what this would mean, you know, to put actors in vintage photographs. And, you know, it sounds good in principle. To do it in reality was very complicated, much more complicated than we imagined, you know, and we had to find a workflow that would be possible, right? Now, remember, this is an independent movie made on an indie budget, and we're contemplating making every shot in the movie visual effects. I mean, that's really daunting. So we had to make choices that would work for this. One of the first things that I saw was, okay, the pictures are in black and white, the people are in color, right? So we got to make a choice. Is it going to be that we're going to colorize the backgrounds so that we can keep the people in color, or are we going to take the people and the furniture and props and make them black and white inside the photographs? The first impulse was to say, well, just go all black and white, you know, that'll work. But during the testing, you know, a wonderful guy, my visual effects supervisor, second unit director, Daniel Lamb, sent me a piece where he just left the people in color and the background was in black and white. And I immediately lit up. I said, no, that's not a mistake. I love that, Daniel. Let's do this. Because I saw right away that it was a really strong and unusual look and a stylized look that suited the fact that this whole story is going to be narrated by Lamon. It's a memory piece, right? It's Lamon telling us what happened. And, you know, when you're coming from memory, it's not an objective documentary-like film. This is a guy remembering what happened and taking us through it. And keeping the actors and the furniture and the props in color and the backgrounds in black and white would instantly signal to the audience that, you know, you're in a new kind of space, right? You haven't been in a space like this before.
Right.
This is it's a very inviting visual space because it says to the audience, we respect you, and we're going to let you sort of close the loop in your own mind. You know, we're not going to spoon feed it to you. And see, if we had done it all black and white, then we'd be in the world of, okay, well, it's visual effects, you need perfect visual effects. I mean, you know, a lot of your listeners are gamers, right? And like action movies and science fiction movies.
Yeah.
In that universe, and I'm one of those guys. In that universe, if a visual effect looks 99% right, it's 100% wrong, right? I mean,
yeah.
it's that terrible, uncanny valley where, like, you know, something's a little off, and it just looks cheesy because you can tell it's an effect.
Mm-hmm.
But when you leave the people in color and the background's in black and white, well, I mean, we're not trying to trick you at all. We're not trying to sell you anything. We're just presenting a new kind of storytelling. And the funny thing is, when it's so obviously collaged, and that's why I ended up calling it cinecollage.
That's what I was going to ask, yeah.
Right. When it's so obviously collaged, your brain, it's this amazing cognitive thing, your brain wants it to be real. You know? So it's like there's nothing real, in quotes, about it, right? People in color, mm-hmm. the backgrounds are in black and white. And yet, you start watching it, and everybody who watches it reports the same thing. Within about a minute, they forget.
You forget that you're looking at pictures, or it's just like a video game. Some of my older son plays, my younger son, actually, and it's like where they're fighting and all, but the background, pretty soon, it's like it's real. It's like you're watching a movie with a real background because your brain turns it on.
Right. It's our nature as human beings. You know, we want things to work. You know, we want to get involved. It's like when you tell your kids a story at bedtime. You know, you're just, what's going on? They're just listening, and you're talking with words that go in their ears. But kids have that wonderful imagination. They start seeing everything that you're saying.
Mm-hmm. We have to go to break because we're at the half hour, so we're going to go to break, and let me get the list up so I know what song. Old Dan Tucker, sung by Bruce Springsteen, because Old Dan Tucker is actually a song that Lyman sings with Mary, with Lincoln's wife and Lincoln, right, in the movie?
Yes, absolutely.
So I chose that by Bruce Springsteen to add to the, the ambience of the movie. And we'll be right back. This is GameCon Radio.
You are listening to GameCon Radio.
Yes?
Hi, I'm here for the New York Ghost Tour.
Sorry, we're closed. But you can come back next week.
Next week? Forget that. I'll just go check out another place.
Trust me, there's no place half as interesting as ours, dear.
That's so not true. What about the Shanley Hotel in Napanock?
Once you've been to one haunted hotel, you've been to them all.
Not like this place. The Shanley Hotel dates back to 1845, and since then it's been a hotspot for paranormal activity. Mysterious music, smells, whistling, doors opening, footsteps, almost everything you can imagine has been experienced at that hotel.
It's open to the public?
Absolutely. Sal and Cindy, the owners of the hotel, welcome people for regular stays or investigations, and their rates are beyond reasonable. They even offer workshops and in-house psychics.
How did you learn about this place?
By visiting www.shanleyhotel.com. You can get history, investigation info, and much more.
Thanks, I think I will. Just don't tell any of our customers.
Your secret's safe with me. It's not like anyone can hear us.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. Tonight, our very special guest, Sal Litvak, is a director and writer of Saving Lincoln. It's a true story about Ward Hill Lamon, who was a U.S. Marshal. He appointed himself Lincoln's personal bodyguard for his 4 years in Washington. And it's an incredibly poignant story. We were just talking about the cinema collage method and how you wanted stage actors, and that's because they need to be on their mark. Everything is like little X's from what I saw in the pictures. Everything is like little X's, and they follow these paths. That has to be hard for an actor.
Yes,
I mean, it's not like actually a stage where you've got the chair there and you've got the table and that, and you can see it. This is a green room with a green floor and a green roof, and there's just X's marking the way, you know?
Yeah, yeah. The furniture was real. But when we were doing outdoor scenes, exactly, they were on a green floor, you know, and they just had to, and we would sort of tell them where things are and what it would look like. What we did do is what's called rough on-set compositing. So we could on our computers on set, we could see what the camera was seeing, and we would put the photograph, you know, the historical photograph in, and we needed to be able to get a rough idea of how the final shot would look so that our camera could be at the same height and distance and lens compared to the actors as the original cameras of, you know, of historical photographers, pioneering photographers like Matthew Brady and Alexander Gardner.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was another really cool part of the process. I mean, you know, it's like we were working with them, right, with these wonderful guys who originated photography back in the 1860s, the first war photographers, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we had to match their angles so with our camera, get the actors into the right places and have a good sense of how they would fit into the photographs in the end. But the thing to understand about cinecollage is that it's not like our people are in the movie are just standing in front of a photograph. Once we reached post-production, we would take this footage that we made during production of the actors in our green screen world, and make a package for every shot of, you know, the shot that came out of our editing room, the photograph from the Library of Congress, you know, in a packet of instructions, and farm these out to all of our compositors. And then each of them would take the shot that they were working on and turn that photograph into a three-dimensional world.
Wow.
By cutting it up into many layers, sometimes even by making a 3D model and skinning it with the photographic material so that the camera could actually appear to move through this photograph taken.
Let me ask, is this like cutting edge new stuff that you developed, or has this technology been used before?
Yeah, the technology itself is not new. I mean, we were using After Effects and Nuke and programs that all visual effects people are familiar with. But what was very new is applying it to vintage photographs and turning those photographs into living worlds. I wouldn't say that the technology is new, but certainly the cinematic style is new. And the concept is new, and that hasn't been done before. And it really, you know, it took so much testing and learning how to do it. We kept joking, you know, during production and post-production that by the time we're done making this movie, we'll know how to make this movie. We were learning, you know,
just
all
think
the way
what
through.
We can do with the next movie.
Exactly. We are now the go-to people for a cinecollage film, and we can talk later about that. We've got some ideas for the next project, but you know, while we're talking, people can see what we're talking about at savinglincoln.com. Our trailer is there. You know, and they can, you know, since we're talking about an unusual look, they should definitely check out the trailer and see what it is we're talking about.
Yeah, you were talking, and I want to, before we run out of time tonight, this cast is amazing. This cast,
yeah.
You know, what did you do? Send out an all-points bulletin for this cast? Because they are an amazing cast that you have together. I mean, Tom, Amanda's, Lee Coco. He's a good-looking kid. He's much better looking than the original Lyman. you know, but how did all of these people get on board with you?
You know, everybody came by a slightly different path. I mean, the first person I want to give credit to is Matt LaSalle, our casting director. Did an incredible job. You know, I mean, this is a very large cast. When you make a movie about a president,
we got
there's going to be a lot of people
excuse
around.
Excuse me, we have a caller. They're going to bring it. Hello, caller?
Hello.
Hello. Your name?
Hi, Renee, Jessica.
Jess. Jess, this is Sal. Sal, this is Jess. Would you like to ask a question?
How long did it take to film the movie?
Production was 1 month. We shot in August of 2011 in downtown Los Angeles at a place called Atomic Studios. And and then we were editing for about 5 months. And, you know, for normal independent film, then we'd be done. Because every shot requires visual effects. Then we were in, you know, in visual effects post-production for another 11 months after that.
Oh, okay. So it's well over a year altogether.
Yes, which, you know, is long for an independent film, but actually quite short for an all-visual effects film. So
okay.
A real tight, nimble team.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jess.
You're welcome. Thank you.
You're welcome. From beginning concept, okay, and we're backtracking just a bit. From the day you said, I want to make a Lincoln movie, to now is how many years?
12.
Oof. That is a huge chunk of life. And your wife hasn't shot you or said, you know, enough, you know?
You know, we were determined. I mean,
yeah.
You know, we did other things in the meantime, but we never lost our intense desire to make a movie about Abraham Lincoln. And, you know, one thing that's really important to know is, as Steven Spielberg himself said, the subject of Lincoln is inexhaustible.
Yeah.
You know, so even if you've seen another Lincoln movie or read Lincoln books, you haven't seen our story. There's so much more here. And in fact, it's funny because, I mean, I saw Steven Spielberg's movie, Lincoln. I think it's great.
Yeah.
But the funny thing is that they had all the resources in the world, and they covered a very narrow chapter. They did the last 4 months of Lincoln's life, and it's about Lincoln the politician getting the 13th Amendment passed through Congress. It's a really cool story, especially for people who enjoy politics and government. And we, you know, the small indie movie, do all 4 years of Lincoln, the commander-in-chief, leading the nation through the Civil War. So, you know, if you're fond of Lincoln, you got to see both movies because they tell such different parts of the story.
Yeah, I do have another question. Actually, somebody asked a question in the chat, which I don't know if you would even have it. But I have a question that I'm going to ask later, so you might want to think about it, is if you learned anything about Lincoln that most people that kind of made you go, wow, you know, but we'll wait for that. The other question is they're asking about, let me find it. Oh, I'm such adult tonight.
Huh.
It was about him being the Pinkerton men. Was there anything to indicate that they were bullies, Alan Pinkerton's men? Because obviously Lyman and Pinkerton did not get along.
They did not get along. They definitely had different ideas of intelligence work and detective work and what was best for Lincoln. They were both dedicated to Lincoln. But, I mean, it's funny, during the war, you know, and there was also an army intelligence unit, but things weren't as organized as they are now. But you know what, even now when things are organized, I'm sure there's occasional friction between the CIA and the FBI and Homeland Security, and it was a similar kind of thing. These were people that had authority over different aspects of the government and the police work, and they would, you know, sort of bump elbows. It really wasn't that important. It was more they criticized each other in their writing later. But
right.
So what?
And of course, it's because they're all writing books and trying to get in newspapers. And yeah, I knew Lincoln. I mean, nothing does more for, you know, writing books and being interviewed as the death of a president, you know, and then you just say, oh yeah, I knew him, you know, so now you've got an audience.
Right, and then you call someone else a liar, and now you've got controversy, and then you're going to get more friends, right?
Right.
So that's all part of it.
I want to go back to this cast because one of the cast in here, Bruce Davidson, is a wonderful actor. I love Bruce Davidson. His character in there, who is he? William H. Seward.
He plays William Seward, mm-hmm. and who was the Secretary of State, and he was the man that everyone thought would end up being president. And it was just an amazing thing that Lincoln did, bringing Seward and Salmon P. Chase, who was another presidential candidate in 1860, into his cabinet, right? Mm-hmm. So the Doris Kearns Goodwin book is called Team of Rivals because Lincoln brought these men who had been his rivals in to help him unite the country when it most needed uniting. Mm-hmm. And Seward was, you know, if Lincoln was a guy from outside the establishment, Seward was the establishment, right?
Right.
He was from New York. He had been in politics all his life. He had been the governor of New York. He was just utterly connected and utterly knowledgeable about politics in Washington and how it all works. And in the beginning, you know, he did not respect Lincoln and was, you know, quite jealous, I think, and a bit resentful. But as he worked with Lincoln and came to know him, they became very close, and he became one of Lincoln's greatest admirers, a guy who could really appreciate everything that Lincoln was doing.
Mm-hmm.
And Bruce does just a terrific job in that part. You know?
Well, he can really make himself look like a real pain in the butt. You know, he's just got that voice. He's got that look that you want to say, come here, I want to slap that off your face. He always has had that, and he's an excellent actor. It is Seward and Lincoln are kind of like the Johnson and Kennedy relationship in the beginning. Johnson was hoping to be president, and Kennedy got the nod, and then Kennedy brings him in as his vice president, you know, so it always makes for intrigue when that happens, but you're right, there was a common respect. How much do you play up with Mary Todd Lincoln in this movie?
Very much. Penelope Ann Miller is just an American treasure. You know, I have been a huge fan of her work for the longest time, and that I actually got to meet with her for this movie was already a big treat for me. And then, you know, that she really just sparked her imagination, what we were doing and how we were going to do it. And the thing that really spoke to her about what Nina and I were talking about in terms of Mary is that, like Lamon, Mary is a misunderstood character in American history.
Mm-hmm.
There's an impression of Mary Lincoln that, you know,
that
she was annoying and shrill and, you know, was just always badgering Lincoln and causing him problems and
spending,
you know, all
money,
this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, and that she went somewhat crazy while they were in the White House. And, you know, let's take a step back here. Mary Lincoln is an American hero as well as an American icon. She mm-hmm. and Lincoln were partners throughout their marriage, okay? He really loved her. She really loved him. They were partners, a partnership, okay? And there was a sweetness to Mary Lincoln that just gets overlooked in history. And you know, as soon as I met with Penelope, I was like, this has got to work because you're going to totally bring this. You know, she was a Southerner. She was from Kentucky. She was from a very established political family, quite a wealthy family. And she went right outside of the, I mean, she just left what she grew up in, right? These mm-hmm. were slave owners, Southerners, you know, really powerful people, and she chose this poor upstart, you know, self-educated country lawyer and said, I'm going with him, you know, and it was, to people in her world, like, what are you talking about? That's crazy. But she believed in Abraham Lincoln, and she said, almost as soon as she met him, this man is going to be president. She always believed in him, and she very much helped make him. And so what was great for us is that Tom, man, this plays like it, and Penelope they're not just a political couple, they're not just a power couple, they're a romantic couple. Mm-hmm. Abraham and Mary Lincoln love each other, you know, and they need to have chemistry together. And you see that in our film. I mean, there's great, great love there. And yeah, Mary had problems when they were in the White House. I mean, not everyone realizes that they lost an 11-year-old son in 1862, you know, at the height of the war. Anyone who has children, you know.
The death of a child will either make you or break you.
Yeah, I mean.
And that's just the way it is, because I lost a child. So it either makes you or it breaks you. And most couples don't survive the death of a child.
That's correct. That's correct. And to survive the death of a child while you're in the national spotlight at war, of a nation at war, I mean, anybody who, you know, says, I'm going to judge that woman for what she does or doesn't do that's a presumption that is, you know, lunacy to me. Mm-hmm. She handled it as best she could. And it was just a terrible, terrible pressure what that poor woman went through. And she handled it very well. And
let
very
me ask you, did Lyman talk about that ever in his book?
Yes. He, later when that book that was ghost written, you know, for him, then he had problems with Mary. But during the White House years and in the years leading up to the White House, there was no problem between Lamon and Mary. As a matter of fact, they bonded because they were both Southerners. They were both Southerners who understood the Southern mind and yet personally rejected slavery and, you know, hung there, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? You know, I mean, they connected themselves to Lincoln and to the Lincoln cause. But they understood each other. You know, they both came from that world of gentility, of Southern manners.
Mm-hmm. In the chat, one of them is saying that Mary Lincoln was nuts from what they read. Depression back then. Did I lose you?
Not just depression.
Yeah, depression
was different.
She
suffered from migraine headaches.
Yeah.
Terrible migraine headaches.
Yeah.
There was no migraine medication.
Nope.
So she would have headaches that would last 3 days.
Yeah.
I mean, screaming, pounding headaches that would last 3 days.
Yeah.
She lost a child. I mean, yeah, there were difficulties. Yeah, there was pressure. But
knowing that somebody's out to kill your husband doesn't help either.
Yeah. You know. Now, one thing that might be a good thing to talk about here in Mo Banshee's lair is something, you know, not a lot of people know about, is that they actually had seances in the White House.
I am aware of that, yeah. But I was trying to keep it mostly on the history, but yeah. after the child died, they definitely were trying, because spiritualism was new then, and the Fox sisters had come out.
It was new and big. It swept the country, because everybody lost people in that war.
Yeah, so that was a huge thing, and they were not above trying it. So they were a very progressive couple by the standards of most people there, you know, in that time in Washington. Your Kickstarter, let's talk about that, because you just finished that. What was that?
Our Kickstarter campaign just ended at 6 p.m. tonight. It went for 33 days. And, you know, as we've been talking about, we made Saving Lincoln in a very innovative way and a very passionate way. And we applied that same innovation and passion to the next phase of our film. This is, again, something independent filmmakers often don't think about, but my producing partner Ruben and I are fairly experienced, and we knew that as important as it is to make a movie, is equally important to connect with your audience and make it, you know, to reach out to them and help them to find your movie, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we've done a number of things. One is Facebook. We've been posting content about Abraham Lincoln, Mary Lincoln, the Civil War, soldiers, historical photographs. I mean, every day, interesting stuff about the period for over a year, and that's why we're approaching 50,000 fans on Facebook. And another tool that we've used is Kickstarter, which is a great platform for creative projects where people can come and become backers in your project. With, you know, it's all kinds of things. It can be anything from a video game or an app, you know, puzzles, books, and also films. Often with people who use Kickstarter for film, it's to fund production. In our case, we had financing for our production, but we used Kickstarter to help us expand our theatrical release. We always kept a little bit of money aside, and we knew that we were going to self-distribute. We just were committed to that from the beginning because of the timing of our project and the fact that, you know, we already know our audience, and we have our audience. We've been building our audience, and we invite people to join us and connect directly with us. So we thought that Kickstarter might be a good way to expand our theatrical release, which was planned to be very limited, just 4 cities, really to get some media awareness of the movie. And then we would go onto DVD and iTunes and all the other platforms very quickly. We're not going to wait 6 months to go to DVD after theatrical.
Let me break in for a second. The current list, Music Hall Theater in Los Angeles, February 15th through the 21st, right?
Yes.
Yes, and then New York Quad Cinema.
Quad Cinema. Also, we're opening on February 15th.
Yeah.
So it was going to be 4 cities, and now, because of our Kickstarter campaign has been so successful, you know, we thought we could just raise $30,000 and maybe get a couple more cities in there.
Yeah.
And we ended up raising $60,000, have over 800 backers, and because so many people came on board and showed, you know, we really want to see this movie, and not only do we want to see it, we're going to put dollars into it now, even before we've seen it, because,
right,
you know, it sounds so cool and we want to know more. Theaters took notice of that. And we were able to go into a partnership with Emerging Pictures, a wonderful company out of New York, and go out to theaters and say, hey, look, you know, people want to see this movie. Do you want to show this movie? And the answer is yes. The theaters have taken notice. And so already we've been able to expand to 16 cities, and that's going to grow. So it's really, you know, it's becoming a bit of a movement, and I'm quite humbled and awed and thrilled.
Yeah, because you know, at first I thought, see, I don't know anything about, you know, producing a movie or anything. You know, you think that, well, it's going to be all over the place, you know, but you have selected cities to bring it out, and then you're going straight to the DVD, and people can order the DVD already, right?
Yes. Well, I mean, they could on our Kickstarter campaign. That just closed, but we're going to, in the next few days, we're going to reopen that possibility through our website. And in any case, in just a few weeks, we're going to be on Amazon. We're going to be on iTunes. We're just going to be all over the place. You know, we want people to see our movie. We're not going to make them wait. We love it when people see it on the big screen and see it in groups. But, you know, people can see it at home also. And we're actually going to be doing something quite cool. We're going to be doing, you know, virtual Q&As where we're going to set up, you know, using Google Hangouts or GoToMeeting or various means where, you know, people can get together in a group or even on their own, see the movie, and then come, you know, into a video chat, basically, and where I will be and answer questions. And, you know, just continuing this process of connecting with our audience. I'm just extremely important to us to be connected to our audience.
Okay, we have to go to a break, and then when we're coming back, I'm going to ask you what you've learned from this whole thing with Lincoln and Lyman's relationship, if you've learned anything new. The last song we're going to do, let me bring it up so I know what I'm talking about, is Mary Don't You Weep by Bruce Springsteen. And we'll be right back with Sal Litvak and Saving Lincoln. Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on Game Con Radio. Tonight, our guest is Sal Litvak, and he's talking about Saving Lincoln, his movie. And I did not understand, there is a seance scene in the movie.
Yes, there is, and I want everyone to understand that this is historically accurate. We're not portraying any supernatural events going on at that seance, but it actually does affect the narrative. Mary is the one who had the real relationship with Nettie Colburn, a medium who was well known at that time. It's understandable. I mean, Mary was desperate to connect with, mm-hmm. with her lost son, William. Not only...
I lost him. Hello, 1, 2, 3.
You're
right. I'm still on. All right, we lost our guest. We're calling him back, everybody. Okay, we're going to try to call him back. But yeah, after Mary, the little boy, Willie, died.
Hello,
we lost your connection. I'm sorry.
Okay,
so
what
Mary,
was the last thing I said?
We were talking about the seance after Mary lost Willie.
Exactly. So not only did Mary lose her 11-year-old boy, Willie, she also lost three brothers who were fighting for the Confederacy, you know, and who died in the war. And, I mean, it was just a universal story in America at that time. It was a country of 30 million people, and 750,000 died in the war. I mean, everybody lost people. Every family lost somebody. And there was this great, you know, need to try to connect with the departed. And this was part of that. And so we portray one of these seances that occurred in the White House. And what was important about it to us, you know, was Nettie Colburn, the medium who wrote the book about it, you know, she talked about what she said to Abraham Lincoln during one of these seances. And essentially it was saying that, you know, you're doing the right thing, you're on track, and the people from the other world all, you know, support you in what you're doing. Now, for Abraham Lincoln to hear that, that's what interested us, right? So here's a man who cannot wring the neck of a chicken, a gentle, sweet man, whom destiny appoints to write the orders that send hundreds of thousands of boys to die, right? Mm-hmm. And now somebody is portending to tell him that those people from the other world are happy with what you're doing.
Right.
Right? Now, whether it's real or not is besides the point. What matters is, what does it feel like to be Abraham Lincoln and confronting, you know, the reality of what you've had to do?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he had to do it. His job was commander-in-chief. He had to tell those armies to advance in order to save the Union and to save the country that he was entrusted with. But to face that much death is an incredibly emotional thing. And so the seance for us was simply a setting where we could explore, you know, Abraham Lincoln's emotional state.
In a way, the putting up with the seance and that type of thing is also a way of helping his wife over that terrible loss.
Yeah,
and the scene in the trailer where she says, I can't mourn my own brothers, is that Mary Lincoln talking there?
Yes.
Oh, my God. That's poignant.
That's exactly right. She was accused in the newspapers of being a Confederate spy in the White House. What's the proof? Her brothers are generals in the Confederate Army.
Yeah, and she says, I don't dare mourn my own family because I'll be called a traitor. That's horrible. That's horrible. There was nothing civil about that war.
Just so. That's exactly right, Mom.
Yeah, and I think that earlier when I was promoing it and talking about the movie, the thing is that you respect Lincoln because he stood the line. He didn't want to be there, you know. He didn't want to stand that line. He didn't want to give those orders, but he did it. And I think in some respects, Lyman and he saw that in each other, willing to stand the line. What do you think?
Yes. Yeah. Exactly right. They were men that did not shirk their responsibility.
Yeah.
And did what he had to do to save the country, and Ward Hill Lamon did what he had to do to save Lincoln.
Yeah. When Lincoln was assassinated, he sent Lamon someplace, and that's why he wasn't there with him, right?
Correct. He sent him to Richmond.
Mm-hmm.
On presidential business three days before. And check this out, Mo. This is true. This is the stuff that if a writer writes it, you're like, well, that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
It would never happen. But this is true, and it was witnessed. The last words that Ward Hill Lamon said to Abraham Lincoln as he was taking his leave to go on this mission that Lincoln was sending him on, and Lamon was leaving reluctantly. He did not want to leave the president's side. He said to Lincoln, do not go out at night, particularly to the theater.
Mm.
Yeah, that's true.
So he
and the reason he said that is because Lincoln went to the theater many times while he was president, and Lamon hated it every time.
Yeah.
How do you protect a man in a large, dark room that's full of people,
right,
any one of whom could be armed? And it was well known that there were plots, you know, abounding to take out Lincoln all the time that he was there. You know, it was impossible to protect him in that situation. And what Lamon never imagined was that ultimately the perpetrator was not somebody in the audience. It was an actor on the stage.
Right.
I mean, Booth was not in the play that night, but Lincoln had been to the theater to see Booth perform.
Right.
While he was president. Booth was, I mean, people don't get it. Booth was a famous actor. It's as if, you know, today, pick your favorite movie star, and that guy got it into his head to go assassinate a president. I mean, it's just unthinkable that that's what happened.
Let me ask you, Tom Amandes and Lee Coco, how was their chemistry working together? Did they have trouble finding their places, or did they fall in well?
Very well, right away. It was so cool. They're both super experienced stage actors.
Mm-hmm.
And interestingly, both very experienced in Chicago theater. Tom grew up in Illinois. He's a Land of Lincoln guy through and through.
Right.
And Lee actually is a Southerner from Mississippi who does sing, and he's a great guitar player, and he learned to play the banjo for our movie, so he plays the banjo himself in the movie. And both of them spent a lot of time in Chicago theater, including doing a lot of Shakespeare, which is a big deal for us because we're very inspired by Shakespeare, and I'm not saying that Nina and I, you know, are of the level of Shakespeare,
right,
but we aspire to write that kind of dialogue and deep dialogue, that, you know, the themes that Shakespeare explored were the deepest themes that there are. He wrote plays about kings and queens because they were family stories that had national and international importance.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what this is. You know, if you were going to do a Shakespearean, if Shakespeare were writing today, he would write about somebody like Abraham Lincoln.
Mm-hmm.
Where it's a family intimate story that has, you know, this tremendous worldwide importance. And also like Shakespeare, you know, Shakespeare was not afraid to ask the audience to use their imagination in some way. You know, in Henry V, I mean, he's taking you to a battlefield at Agincourt and, you know, and doing that on a theater. How do you do that? Well, you just do it, you know, because that's part of the story, and you find a way to represent it, and then the audience takes the ride with you. And that's what we did as well. And so in our movie, we go actually to the war itself. This is not a movie just about, you know, Lincoln's office and the dining room. We go to the battlefield. Lincoln is the only president to stand in the line of fire on a battlefield. When he
right.
stood at Fort Stevens on July 12th, 1864. And, I mean, that's where we start the movie, and that's where we come back to near the climax, is why did Abraham Lincoln, who was told, get on a boat and go to safety when Washington was being invaded in the summer of 64, and instead went out to the front line, walked up on the parapet, and stood in the line of fire while men right next to him were shot and killed.
Mm.
Right? What was going through his mind? He wasn't there to give orders.
No.
It's not that he was the general telling the men what to do. He just stood in the line of fire looking at the Confederates out there and placing himself in mortal danger. Why?
Mm-hmm.
That was a fascinating question to us. And
do you think
right
you've answered it? Do you think you've answered it in your film?
Yes.
Cool. I'm not going to ask you to answer it here because I want people to see your film. Dave Alvin sings the one song in there, and it's awesome. Wayfaring Stranger.
And he also sings Battle Hymn of the Republic. Both
right.
Haunting, incredible songs you'll never forget.
Yeah, he's got that voice, you know, and it's amazing, the cast. Tom Amandes, a great character actor. They're all fabulous. And
don't forget Creed Bratton from The Office, who just has a terrific turn. You know, he's known for comedy on The Office. He plays Senator Charles Sumner. And does a fantastic job, you know, and facing, again, a kind of pressure that you wouldn't imagine Lincoln had to face, right? The great Abraham Lincoln. Well, in the months leading up to the re-election in 1864, what the Republican Party wanted from Abraham Lincoln was to step aside because he was unelectable, as far as they were concerned. The war had gone so badly for so long that the party was going to lose if Abraham Lincoln was their candidate. And it, you know, there's Charles Sumner who comes to Lincoln and says, you've got to step aside. You know, you're like Moses. You led us to the promised land, but now Joshua is going to take us in. You got to step aside.
Right.
You know, it's amazing.
Mm-hmm. It's time to heal, and you're just adding salt to the wound by being there. Yeah. Let me ask you, what did you learn from this whole thing?
No, what I learned was a lot. I mean, what you're asking me is what I learned about Abraham Lincoln.
Right.
And, you know, I learned many, many things, but you know what I want to share with you? I want to share with you what I learned yesterday. I realized something yesterday that I'd never realized before, and I was almost dumbstruck by it. You know, I told you the whole story of how we originally wrote Lincoln's Hat and ultimately wrote and made Saving Lincoln. And when we originally came to the Lincoln story and, you know, and called it Lincoln's Hat, there was a question that fascinated us, which is, why would such a tall man wear such a tall hat?
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, imagine this guy. He's a foot taller than everybody else. He stands out like a sore thumb. And on top of that, he's got the tallest hat in the room, right?
And he's skinny as a rail.
And he's skinny as a rail, right? I mean, that hat is like an extra foot on his head, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why? What is it about that hat? You know, and we had many answers, and, you know, this was a guy who wanted to seem like a gentleman because he came from outside the establishment, and he used that hat as an office. He carried all his important papers in it. There were a lot of different reasons. But this is what I just realized. When Willie died, Lincoln put a mourning band on that hat. It was about maybe a 3-inch wide black ribbon that went around the hat. You can still see it on some of the hats that have been preserved, and you can certainly see it in the photos. By the time he appeared at Antietam, in the famous photograph of Lincoln and his generals,
mm-hmm.
anybody can see it online anytime. Just, you know, look up Lincoln and his generals or Lincoln Antietam. That image is everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
You look at that picture, and what you see is that the mourning band has grown. It's almost as tall as the hat itself. There's maybe a half inch between the top of the mourning band and the top of the hat. Okay, the mourning band is now like a foot wide, maybe not that, 10 inches wide, whatever it is. It's why, right?
Mm-hmm.
Abraham Lincoln was destined to wear that hat because Abraham Lincoln was destined to be the man who would carry the weight of the nation on his shoulders. He was maybe the only man that would give all those orders for all those boys to go and die and be able to do that at the same time that he took every one of those deaths personally.
Right.
He cared. Mm-hmm. He cared about every single boy who mm-hmm. gave his life to save the Union and to end slavery. He took every loss personally.
Yeah.
And that's why that mourning band is so large. He mourned not only for the loss of his own son, but for the loss of every mother and father's son.
Right.
You say
that's
that he was stooped? Oh, yeah. Imagine carrying that weight on your mm-hmm. shoulders. You know, and you can see it visually in that picture with that very wide mourning band. He needed a hat that tall
mm-hmm.
to ultimately carry that mourning band.
And with that, we are done with our interview. I can't tell you how interesting this was and over the moon I am that you came on the show to talk to us about it. I definitely will be promoting this, and I hope you wonderful things. I really do. Is this going to be like, is there any chance this will be submitted to one of like the festivals, the film festivals?
Well, usually film festivals don't want to play films after they've been released commercially.
Okay.
And, you know, right now there's this Lincoln fervor. We knew that it was coming during the course of our production. We realize, oh, well, Steven Spielberg is finally making his movie.
and he's also a vampire killer now, too. Yeah.
Exactly. And there's one coming on television. I mean, you know, this is really the time to be out there with a Lincoln movie. And that's why we chose to go to our audience directly and not spend the year on the festival circuit that independent films often take. So certainly, I think festivals probably will still want to play our film because they can gather audiences, and people, I think, are going to really enjoy watching this film communally as a group and talking about it afterwards, and I'm happy to talk with audiences anytime. But we want to get the movie out there now.
Right.
We want people to see it.
And so now you tell everybody where they can find you, where they can find the DVD, everything you need them to know.
Right. So the main thing is savinglincoln.com. Very easy to remember, savinglincoln.com. We're Saving Lincoln on Facebook, and that's a great place to talk with us. You know, we're constantly having conversation, and our audience is just very involved every time we put content out, and we do it every day, photographs, quotes, sayings, all kinds of stuff about Lincoln and the Civil War and Lamon. And we have a huge engagement with our audience, just always thousands of likes and hundreds of shares and comments and discussion, and very engaging. You can also ask U.S. Marshal Ward Hill Lamon a question. He's on Twitter. That's at twitter.com/savinglincoln. And he's been telling stories about his time with Lincoln and catching spies, assassins, and traitors during the Civil War. Those stories have been collected on savinglincoln.com. But he's also interacting with the audience. So if you want to talk with Marshal Lamon about how he protected Lincoln, how he saved Lincoln, how he helped Lincoln save the nation, go to Twitter and you can ask Lamon a question. And you can see our stuff on YouTube. I mean, the main thing is see our trailer. All you have to do is Saving Lincoln trailer and you'll find it. If you become enthusiastic about the movie, as so many people are, then you'll want to see it. And we're in 16 cities. That's growing. The movie will come out February 15th, and then it'll be available widely shortly after that. And I really invite everybody to see the movie and join the conversation.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you point blank that the trailer is amazing, and I think that it's going to be a big hit, and God bless you for doing it, and I wish you all the best in the world. When you have
a new project, come back. And thank you so much for having me on the show. There's been a great opportunity, and God bless you and all your listeners.
Okay. All you've got to do is hang up, and you're good to go, okay?
Okay. Take care. Thank you.
Night-night. That was amazing. I cannot stress enough how incredible this movie looks. When you watch the trailer, it draws you right in. You realize that there's a man fighting tooth and nail to protect the president of the United States, his best friend, and the president is doing everything he can possibly do to put himself in jeopardy. And it's this strife between the two men, but there's such a bond there. It's going to be an incredible movie. I hope everybody gets to see it. Please support it. Send all the links around. Let it go viral. Next week, we're going to have Kirby Robinson on. He is a investigator for unexplained phenomena, and he has written a book called Never Mock God. It is about his unauthorized investigation of a paranormal state case that was on television, and his findings on it. So I hope everybody tunes in for that. You can always find me at asylumsgate.com. You can always find me on Facebook, Mo Banshee, and you can find me here. Game Con Radio has a lot of different kinds of shows, DJs, everything from rock to talk to all kinds of things. Please check out our schedule page. I want to thank everybody for listening. And again, everybody be safe out there, because we've got some really bad weather coming into the Ohio Valley and moving its way east. It's going to be snow, sleet, ice, rain, frigid temperatures. Take care of your animals, take care of your families, and everybody be safe. God bless you. I love you. Good night.
Somewhere over the rainbow, birds fly. Birds fly over the rainbow.
For visiting me at my lair. Mo Banshee's Lair is broadcast live on Tuesday evenings at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Mountain, 7 p.m. Pacific, and in the UK, 3 a.m. Wednesday mornings on www.gameconradio.com. You can listen to our recent recordings on Podomatic/Mo Banshee. You can contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for listening. God bless you and yours, and have a very cool day. Oh,